Hi. What I was just playing then, I had totally forgotten. Because I composed it about a year ago and recorded a version of the title page and dedication to Shakespeare's sonnets. I recorded a version which you'll be seeing a bit later in the video, but I totally forgot about it until I looked through my computer files last night and rediscovered it. At the end of the video will be another version of the title page and dedication for Shakespeare's sonnets, which is already on YouTube, that one. So what this collection is, it's some of Shakespeare's sonnets, which are a bit different. Some of the arrangements are different from the versions that are on the Every Word album. I'll be doing another video for Every Word called Every Word Extended, because I've done a few more since I released the Every Word album, excuse me. but what this is, I've called it Extracts from Every Word, and they're videos that I made or have made over the last few years. On the Herald album is a version of Sonnet 18, Shall I Compare Thee to a Summer's Day, which was from August 2002. And I must say I felt very elated after I'd recorded that. And now here we are in August 2016. And since then, since 2002, I've put a lot of other sonnets by Shakespeare, and one anonymous sonnet to music, and I really enjoy doing it. It became a kind of obsession, because every few days I tend to come up with new chords, new melodies, and if I haven't got my own song, I would look through Shakespeare's sonnets and pick out one for that particular chord sequence, that particular arrangement. So on the album Every Word, which is on the Bandcamp website, www.geoffsalt.bandcamp.com, you'll find the Every Word album. I think there's about 26 tracks. But as I say, I'll do another video soon with those 26 and 4 or 5 more that have come along more recently. So over the years since 2002, various arrangements came along and I did various videos. Some of the videos I did straight to YouTube in 2010, 2011, live to YouTube. They're on my YouTube channel, Geoff Salt, on YouTube. But they were live to YouTube, so I don't have any files. I don't have any versions. So you'll have to look at them live on YouTube. And they were recorded when I lived in Osborne Road in Windsor. Now, after I moved here to Slough, just over 3 years ago, in 2013, I started doing more serious recording of the sonnets on my trusty Sony Vaio, with my trusty, there it is there, Sony stereo microphone plugged in. And the collection just grew and grew, so I finished that in 2015, more or less. So over 2 years living here, I recorded the Every Word album. So why is it called Every Word? Well, the sonnets are quite intriguing, and that expression, Every Word, is in Sonnet 76. And the poet writes, "Why write I, still one, ever the same, and keep invention in a noted weed, that every word doth almost tell my name, showing their birth and where they did proceed. Now, noted weed is an unusual expression. It could be read as not Edweed, not Edweed. I keep invention in a not Edweed. But every word doth almost tell my name. Well, every word doth almost tell my name is like a crossword clue. Every word doth almost tell my name. So every word is singled out there. It doth almost tell my name. So every word could be an anagram. And one of the anagrams of every word is Edward Vere, which sounds a little bit like Edward Vere. So one theory about the sonnets is that they were written by Edward de Vere, the Earl of Oxford. So that's my take on it. I mean, who knows, really? The sonnets appeared in, or they were published, according to the record, in 1609, and the title page had Shakespeare's Sonnets across the top, under a beautiful kind of banner pattern across the top of the page. Shakespeare's Sonnets. The word Shakespeare was hyphenated, Shakespeare's Sonnets, never before imprinted. And underneath never before imprinted are two parallel lines. Now, normally when books came out with two parallel lines on the title page, the author's name was put in there, whoever the author was. But on Shakespeare's sonnets, there are those two parallel lines, and it's blank. There's no name in there, which is odd. I mean, if it was believed that Shakespeare from Stratford was the author, they would either have put his name in there, William Shakespeare, or they wouldn't have put those parallel lines there at all, but they're left blank. And in Elizabethan times, a hyphenated name was sort of thought of as a pseudonym. And then between the parallel lines, it's blank. So we just have to kind of draw our own conclusions about that. There's a lot you can read about the sonnets, interpretations and analyses and so on. Basically, there are four characters involved in the sonnets, it would seem. There's the poet, and then the first 17 sonnets seem to be addressed to a young man encouraging him to marry. Sonnet 1 starts off, from fairest creatures we desire increase, that thereby beauty's rose might never die. But as the riper should by time decease, his tender heir might bear his memory. So the first 17 sonnets seem to be addressed to a young man. Sonnet 18, shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more temperate and more lovely. Is that right? Have I got that right? No, I've got the words the wrong way round. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all too short a date. So, is that addressed to the young man as well? It's difficult to know, really, whether it's the same author all the way through every sonnet. Some of the sonnets are addressed to a dark lady. Some people have interpreted the dark lady as being Elizabeth I. Other people have said that she was a lover of Shakespeare, and also, or a lover of the poet, who may have been Shakespeare, and also the lover of the beautiful youth, the young man who's addressed at the beginning of the collection. And Amelia Bassano Lanya has been suggested by some people as the Dark Lady. Other people have suggested that she was using Shakespeare as a pseudonym herself, and that she was the poet and wrote the plays and the sonnets. And I mean, there are lots of different alternative candidates for Shakespeare, as well as the man from Stratford, who's obviously the traditional orthodox suggestion, proposal. There's also Edward de Vere, there's Amelia Bassano Lanya has been suggested, William Stanley, the Earl of Derby, there's all kinds of people, Sir Francis Bacon, Mary Sidney, the Countess of Pembroke. Most of these people were probably all known to each other, so it may have been a group effort. But one thing's quite interesting is that the Elizabethans were very into numerology, codes, hidden messages, and so on. And one thing that intrigues me about the sonnets is that all of them, there are 154 of them, and all of them are written with, I don't know the technical term, iambic pentameter, might be. They're written with 10 syllables in each line. From fairest creatures we desire increase. That's 10 syllables. That's the first line of Sonnet 1. They're all written like that, apart from Sonnet 145. Sonnet 145, which is in this collection, in this video, a sort of alternative version of it, the version on every word that I do is just me and guitar, but this version has bass and another vocal in the background that were coming off my hi-fi from another take I did. So anyway, Sonnet 145 has 8 syllables a line. Thy lips which love's own hand did make. That's 8 syllables in every line. And it does seem a little bit more uncomplicated, the wording, compared with some of, with all the other sonnets. And also, 1 and 4 and 5 add up to 10. 1 and 4 and 5. 1 and 4 is 5, 5 and 5 is 10, 1 and 0 is 1. So Sonnet 145, numerologically, is 1. So maybe it's the first one. Maybe it was done much earlier. And there is a kind of play on words in towards the end of Sonnet 145, which some people have commented on. I'll read it out. Those lips which love's own hand did make breathed forth the sound that said I hate. To me that languished for her sake, but when she saw my woeful state, straight in her heart did mercy come, chiding that tongue that ever sweet was used in giving gentle doom, and taught it thus anew to greet. I hate, she altered with an end, that followed it as gentle day doth follow night, who like a fiend from heaven to hell is flown away. I hate, from hate away she threw, and save my life, saying, not you. I hate, from hate away she threw, and save my life, saying, not you. Now some commentators have said, I hate, from hate away she threw. Hate away is very similar to Hathaway, and Shakespeare of Stratford, of course, was married to Anne Hathaway. And in the very last line, and saved my life, saying not you. I hate, from hate away she threw, Anne saved my life, saying not you. Some people have said it's like Anne, he's talking about Anne Hathaway. So maybe out of this collection, William Shakespeare did write at least that one, but who knows? whether the original manuscripts will ever be found is open to conjecture. No one's ever found the original manuscript of the sonnets. Various printed copies exist from 1609, I think from a bit later on. But the original manuscripts have never been found. Same for the plays, the original manuscripts signed off, you know, William Shakespeare or whoever, have never been found. Although there is something written in what they call Hand D, which was for a play, Sir Thomas More, that may be the poet's hand, but there's nothing really to link that manuscript, that bit of paper, with William Shakespeare of Stratford. It's just a manuscript in a very beautiful handwriting. It's a famous speech in Sir Thomas More, which was used recently in a TV programme that came from Stratford to celebrate William Shakespeare's anniversary, 400 years since he was born. Sorry, since he passed away, since he died in 1616, 400 years ago. So, in this collection of videos, I've got different sonnets. Some of them are the same arrangements as in the Every Word album, and some of them are different, or a little bit different, in different keys. And there's one that I've added to this collection, which so far isn't in the Every Word collection, isn't in the Every Word album. And I only discovered that one last night. I'd totally forgotten that I'd recorded it. But I thought I'd put it in, and it was my first attempt at that particular sonnet. And I'm talking now off the top of my head, and I can't remember the number of the sonnet, and I can't hardly remember the opening line. I think it's something like, "What is the substance whereof are you made?" And I've only done one through of that one, and it's in this collection. And I think I had a cold at the time, but I kind of liked it because it's so relaxed. And a lot of these sonnets, I haven't learnt them by heart, so you can see that I'm reading the text, because it's a lot. There are a lot to remember. Some I remember, anyway. I think that's about it for now. I'll wrap it up. So what you'll hear at the beginning, the first track, will be the title page and dedication. Some people even think the dedication is encoded, and if you just to give you an example, at the beginning of Shakespeare's sonnets is a title page in the 1609 edition. Shakespeare's sonnets, never before imprinted, and then the name of the printers and the publishers, and the date, 1609. And then there's this text, and it's printed right at the beginning of Shakespeare's sonnets, 1609, and it's all in capitals, and after every word there is a period, there's a full stop, which may or may not be significant. And this is what it says: "To the only begetter of these ensuing sonnets, Mr. W.H., all happiness and that eternity promised by our ever-living poet, wisheth the well-wishing adventurer in setting forth, T.T. So the first thing that you'll hear, the first video, is all of that put to music. Then at the very end, I've got a different version, different arrangement, which is from the Every Word album. And the video sort of pans around my flat here and actually shows the print, the title page and the dedication printed out. So you can see what it looked like in the original edition of Shakespeare's sonnets. And people have written books about decoding that dedication to the only begetter of these ensuing sonnets. There's one book called The Devere Code that came out a few years ago, which is very, very interesting to read, because you can, all those letters and words, you can put in different grids, different frameworks, you know, say nine lines, 16 columns, and all kinds of other words start to appear. And of course, the Egyptians, I meant the Elizabethans, but maybe it applies to the Egyptians as well. They were in, you know, the Elizabethans loved codes and ciphers and hidden messages. And of course, this came out of, with Elizabeth I, there was a huge espionage network throughout Britain and the continent, with, you know, Elizabeth had her agents, her intelligencers, travelling around and gathering information, sending back letters in some sort of diplomatic bag, I suppose, and perhaps they were coded in some way. And various people visited the continent with special permission from Elizabeth, including Edward de Vere, Francis Bacon and his brother Anthony Bacon visited the continent. I think William Stanley, the Earl of Derby, and even, you know, Amelia Bassano Lanya may have visited various places. Her family, her father Baptista Bassano, had come from Italy, he'd come from Venice as a court musician for Henry VIII, and so Amelia Bassano Lanya was half Italian. So it's, you have to read the books on all these people. It's quite fascinating. The last 10 years have been fascinating. Well, really since 1997, as I explained in my video for Herald, visiting Shakespeare's Globe, and I started going to authorship conferences at Shakespeare's Globe, and there's a Shakespeare Authorship Trust, a website. I think Mark Rylance is one of the trustees, and he was certainly there at some of the early conferences I went to in 98 and 99, I think. And just going to the authorship conferences was quite fascinating. Various experts would give talks on their candidate for the authorship, including Hank Whitmore, who's very supportive of Edward de Vere. And he has his own blog on the internet. So there were speakers at these conferences for supporting Mary Sidney, Countess of Pembroke, Edward de Vere, just trying to think, Christopher Marlowe, you see, he's another one that people have thought of. Ros Barber is very supportive of Christopher Marlowe. But the story, the official story, of course, is that he died in a tavern brawl. I think it was 1593. So that precludes him from writing anything later. I mean, some of the works were published much later, written, and apparently written much later. And of course, there is the theory that his demise in the so-called tavern in Deptford was a ruse to allow him to escape the Star Chamber and travel abroad, and that somebody else was buried in Deptford. He was supposed to have been killed in a reckoning over the bill, an argument over the bill at the end of the day's eating and drinking at this house in Deptford, which was Mrs. Bull's house. It was known as a safe house, and apparently he was with his friends. I won't go into the whole story because other people have done that elsewhere, but he was with some associates all day, quietly talking, eating and drinking, and then apparently at the end of the day they had an argument over the bill and the reckoning, and Marlowe was killed, apparently. And there was an inquest, and there is an official sort of, that was only found quite recently, the report of the inquest, in the last 200 years. I can't quite remember exactly when it came to light, maybe around 1920, something was discovered, the official report. And there is something, I think it's in As You Like It, there is a reference in Shakespeare's play As You Like It, As You Like It, there is a reference to a reckoning in a little room. And also in, so that's like a reference to Marlowe's passing, or apparent passing. And another interesting thing, I better finish now because I'm going on a bit, I tend to. There's something in The Merry Wives of Windsor, which is quite intriguing. There's a reference to one of the Psalms by the waters of Babylon, There We Sat and Wept, which is, I think it's the parson in The Merry Wives of Windsor, starts to sing this, for no apparent reason, by the waters of Babylon, There We Sat and Wept, which is the psalm about the exile of the Israelites in Babylon. By the waters of Babylon, there we sat and wept, when we remembered thee, O Zion. So it's a psalm of exile. And there is a reference to one of Marlowe's great poems, Come Live With Me and Be My Love and We Will All the Pleasures Prove, which was like a well-known poem at that time. So there's a link there between exile and Marlowe. But who knows, it could have been a whole group of people, or it may have been just William Shakespeare from Stratford. He was certainly a living, real person at that time. He was known in the theatre, he had shares in the Globe Theatre. So he was a real person who lived, and he may have written Sonnet 145 as his contribution, as well as giving his name for the past 400 years to the whole project. Anyway, I've said much more than I meant to say, and I'm sure I'll be corrected on a lot of it, because I haven't got any notes. This is it. It'll be, I think it's about 3/4 of an hour of different videos. And mainly it's just me singing here in this room. I recorded all of these in this room. Some of the ones that are on YouTube, the early ones back in 2010, 2011, were done in Windsor. But the ones that were done here were done with slightly better equipment, better microphone and so on. So there we are. I hope you enjoy the videos. Thanks for watching.
Shakespeare's sonnets
ensuing sonnets, Mr. W. H. All happiness and that eternity promised by our ever-living poet. Wishes the well-wishing adventurer, inserting forth T.T. Shakespeare's sonnets, never before imprinted at London, at London, at London. Lifts up his burning head, each under eye doth homage to his new appearing sight, serving with looks his sacred majesty, and having climbed the steeper heavenly hill. Resembling strong youth in his middle age, yet mortal looks adore his beauty still. Attending on his golden pilgrimage, but when from highmost pitch, with weary car, like feeble age, he reeleth from the day. The eyes for duteous now converted are from his low tract, and look another way. So thou thyself art going in thy noon, unlooked on diest, unless thou get a son. I do count the clock that tells the time, and see the brave day sunk in hideous night. When I behold the violet past prime, and sable curls all silvered o'er with white. When lofty trees I see barren of leaves, which as from heat did canopy the herd, and summer's green all girded up in sheaves, born on the bier with white and bristly beard. Then of thy beauty do I question make, that thou among the wastes of time must go, since sweets and beauties do themselves forsake, and die as they see others grow. And nothing against time's scythe can make defense, save breed to brave him when he takes thee hence. And And nothing against time's scythe can make defense, save breed to brave him when he takes thee hence. When lofty trees I see barren of leaves, which as from heat did canopy the herd, and summer's green all girded up in sheaves, born on the bier with white and bristly beard. Then of thy beauty do I question make, that thou among the wastes of time must go, since sweets and beauties do themselves forsake, and die as they see others grow. And nothing against time's scythe can make defense, save breed to brave him when he takes thee hence. And nothing against time's scythe can make defense, save breed to brave him when he takes thee hence. trouble deaf heaven with my bootless cries. I look upon myself and curse my fate, wishing me like to one more rich in hope, featured like him, with friends possessed, desiring this man's art and that man's scope, with what I most enjoy, content at least. And when the piece was myself almost despising, I think on thee and then my state, like to the lark, a break of day arising from sullen earth, Simpsons at heaven's gates, heaven's gates. For thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, that then I scorn to change my state with kings. For thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, that then I scorn to change my state. Disgrace with fortune and men's eyes, I all alone bereaved my outcast state, and troubled deaf heaven with my bootless cries, and look upon myself and curse my fate, wishing me more like to one rich in hope, like him with friends possessed, desiring this man's art and that man's scope, with what I most enjoy, content at least. And in these thoughts myself almost despising, haply I think on thee and then my state, like to the lark at break of day arising, from sullen earth sings hymns at heaven's gate. For thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, but then I scorn to change my state with kings. For thy sweet love remembered wealth brings, but then I scorn to change my state with kings. When to the sessions of sweet silent thought I summon up remembrance of things past, I sigh the lack of many thing I sought, and with old woes new wail my dear time's waste. Then can I drown an eye and use it to flow for precious friends hid in death's dateless night, and weep afresh love's long since cancelled woe, of many a vanished sight. Then can I grieve of grievances foregone, and heavily from woe by the count of many a four bemoaned moan, which I knew pay as if not paid before. But if the while I think on me, dear friend, all losses are restored and sorrows end. But if the while I think on me, dear friend, all losses are restored and sorrows end. Eclipses stain both moon and sun, and loathsome canker lives in sweetest bud. All men make faults, and even I in this, authorizing thy trespass with compare, myself corrupting, solving thy amiss, excusing thy sins more than thy sins are. For to thy sensual fault I bring incense, thy adverse party is thy advocate. Against myself a lawful plea commence. Such civil war is in my love and hate, that I an accessory needs must be to that sweet thief which Sally robs from me, that I an accessory. Stain both moon and sun, and loathsome canker lives in sweetest bud. All men make faults, and even I this, authorizing thy trespass with compare, myself corrupting, solving thy amiss, excusing thy sins more than thy sins are. What is your substance? Whereof are you made? That millions of strange shadows on you tend. Since everyone hath everyone one shade, and you but one, can every shadow lend? Describe Adonis. The counterfeit, the fully imitated after you. On Helen's cheek, all art of beauty set. You in Grecian tires, I painted you. Speak of the spring, season of the year. Appear, and you in every blessing shape we know in all external grace. You have some part, but you like none, none you for constant hearts on Helen's cheek. Of beauty sat, and you in Grecian tires, I painted you.
Boughs which shake against the cold, their ruined choirs where late the sweet birds sang. In me thou seest the twilight of such day. as after sunlight fadeth in the west, which by and by black night doth take away, that second self that seals up all in rest. That time of year, that time of year, that time of year, that time of year. In me thou seest the glowing of such fire, that on the ashes of his youth doth lie, as the deathbed whereon it must expire, consumed with that which it was nourished by. This thou perceives which makes thy love more strong, to love that well which thou must leave alone. This thou perceives which makes thy love more strong, to love that well which thou must leave alone. That time of year, that time of year, that time of year, that time of year. friend, you never can be old, for as you were when first your eye, such seems your beauty still. Three winters cold have from the far is shook three summers' pride, three summers' pride. Three beauteous springs to yellow autumn turned, in process of the seasons have I seen. Three April perfumes in three hot Junes burned, since first I saw you fresh, which yet are green, which yet are green. Ah, yet doth beauty like a dial hand steal from his figure and no pace perceived. So your sweet hue, which methinks still doth stand, hath motion, and mine eye may be deceived. For fear of which, hear this, thou age unbred, ere you were born was beauty's summer dead. For fear of which, hear this, thou age unbred, ere you were born was beauty's summer dead. Beauty's summer dead. of my harmful deeds that did not better for my life provide than public means which public manners breeds. Then comes it that my name receives a brand, and almost thence my nature is subdued to what it works in, like the dyer's hand. pity me then and wish I were renewed. Us like a willing patient, I will drink potions of ice against my strong infection. No bitterness that I will bitter think, nor double penance to correct correction. Pity me then, dear friend, and I assure ye, even that your pity is enough to kill me. Pity me then, dear friend, and I assure ye, even that your pity is enough to kill me.
Followed it as gentle day,
that follow night. Ooh, just like a field from heaven to hell is flown away. I hate from hate the way she threw and saved my life, saying not you. I hate from hate the way she threw and saved my life, saying not you. I hate 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 not you. My love is as a fever longing still for that which longer nurseth the disease, feeding on that which doth preserve the ill, the uncertain sickly appetite to please. My reason, the physician to my love, angry his prescriptions are not kept, hath left me. And I desperate now approve, desire is death which physic did accept. Past cure I am, now reason is past care, and frantic mad with evermore unrest. My thoughts and my discourse as madmen's are, at random from the truth vainly expressed. I have sworn thee fair and thought thee bright, who art as black as hell, as dark as night. For I have sworn thee fair and thought thee bright, who art as black as hell, as dark as night. Shakespeare's sonnets, never before imprinted. At London, by GL40T, and to be sold by William Astley. 1609, to the only begetter of these ensuing sonnets. Mr. W.H., all happiness and that eternity promised by our ever-living poet, wisheth the well-wishing adventurer in setting forth TT. Shakespeare's sonnets, never before imprinted. At London, by GL40T, are to be sold. William Astley, 1609.